Hi, I'm Spencer. I'm a .NET consultant and Microsoft MVP, and this is Building APIs with C# and ASP.NET Core. I created this course because I believe that ASP.NET Core is the best web framework in the world, and I wanted to show people how I use it to build real apps. In this course, I'll demonstrate the most important parts of the framework and how to write integration tests for your APIs. We'll also explore database access using Entity Framework Core and show best practices around using it. Take what you learned in this course and use it to build bulletproof, production-ready APIs with ASP.NET Core. We need to build out this API. So we're going to start with the most basic possible in-memory database. We're going to go back and reach back to our list. So this is definitely, we will be taking this application as we go and refactoring it to use something real. This is not something that I would write for a production app, but we want to take this one step at a time. We're going to take this and just show you the API as it should be built for now and just kind of forget about the data storage. So I'm going to say new list of employee, boom. Okay, so this is going to be our data store for all of our employees. We'll go ahead and hard code in a couple of employees. Let me go down here, just copy paste these in. Use array initializer syntax. Just go there with little squigglies. Or actually, we'll just call employees.add, which is what this does. It will tell you collection initialization can be simplified. It'll give you that nice little light bulb. So we'll go ahead and do that and make it look all pretty. All right, now let's finally write our first employee endpoint. So I'm going to say app.mapget, and we're going to say /employees. Now I mentioned that we could use request delegate or we can use delegate. In this case, we're just going to use delegate. And like I said, we're going to use delegate pretty much for the remainder of this course. So it can be any old function. It could even be a function that doesn't return anything if you so choose. But in this case, we are going to return something, which is we're going to return our employees list. Now, this is something that we can do, and if we play this application and run it, go back here, 5230 is our 5230, and then we're going to say employees. And you're going to see that, yeah, we get back our data. But this is one of those spicy take moments, which is that you can choose to return just the employee list as it is. But in pretty much every case, I'm going to choose to just return it as the status code that it was intended to be. I never return anything that isn't tied directly to an HTTP status code. And the way that you get those status codes is you can go and cut that and say results.ok. I do this for explicitness. I do this because I build a lot of APIs, and I want to be very explicit about the status codes that I'm returning to the client. We'll also get a single employee endpoint. So if we go down here, paste that in, and you can see that we are calling single or default. So let me break this down a little bit, calling single or default to get that single person. But wait, how does it know what ID it is? I mean, we're just passing it a function, right? Well, we can define what's called a route parameter. And inside of our route here, we can say, hey, you can expect that you will get an ID as part of this endpoint. And after that, after you execute that, which we'll show you in a second, we just run our code to say var employee single or default. We're looking for an employee with that. And we're expecting that there's either going to be one or zero of this employee with that unique ID. And if that employee is null, we're going to say return results not found. Otherwise, we're going to say return results employee. And you can see why if you just tried to return the employee straight up, you can do that. Except for that the compiler is now going to complain at you because it actually thinks that there's a separate function signature that should be there. It really wants you to have one return type, but you can see how just trying to return like an employee's object, that constrains you to only having one status code. So use the results class for sure. Okay. Now that we've got that, we can also constrain this to say that this should only be an int. So we can basically say that the route constraint that we've said is that anything that happens after employee slash, it must match as an integer in order for this endpoint to be hit. All right, let's take a look. Let's run these. So we're gonna run, let's see, 5230, perfect. And then I'm going to use my employees get, so you can see that we're returning results.ok, but we get the exact thing that we expect. And then I am going to duplicate this. And we're going to say employee slash one. And you're going to see that we get back our John Doe object because that's our employee with ID one. We're going to run our solution. And we're going to try to do our request. And we're going to see something that's already leaps and bounds better, right? We're going to see the exact name of the member that threw the error in this case, because our JSON body doesn't include a last name. We're going to give it the, it's going to tell us that, we got hung up on the last name property. And by the way, here's the error message. We're already light years ahead of where we were, right? Because we're at least giving something useful to the client. A React app could take this and interpret it and then show an error message on the screen to say, hey, this thing is not valid. But it's still not technically in problem details format. You'll notice that if we go here, if I look, results.badRequest is just taking in a validation result, and it doesn't say, hey, you know, return a problem detail. We want that nice spec. We are making an API that we want developers to love to use. So thus, we want to make sure that we're returning validation problems in a way that's kind of standard. And we're going to standardize that across our API. So the way that we do that is by a handy little extension method, and we're going to use that to basically take in a list of validation results and return validation problem details. So we're gonna make an extension method to do that. I'm gonna stop my application. I'm gonna go here, I'm gonna hit the plus sign. Oh, that's on that, that's on the solution. I'm gonna say, I'm gonna add a class and I'm gonna call it extensions. And when I'm making projects and I'm adding custom behavior and want to be able to just quickly convert one thing to another, I'm using extension methods constantly. It's one of my favorite, extension methods are one of my favorite language features. And it's not super important that you know what this is because, spoiler alert, it's not gonna exist forever, but I'm gonna go ahead and import this. And you're gonna see that, we're gonna import this as well. And you're gonna see that we create a validation problem details, we spin through our validation results, and then we basically just go through and add it in the format that validation problem details expects. I do wanna touch on this because earlier I said problem details, but why am I saying validation problem details? Well, validation problem details is a derived type of problem details. It's a derived type. So you see, I'm just clicking, let me do that again. Just to show you. So this, as I mentioned, I do this a lot. I navigate source code. So I'm holding command and I'm clicking on it. You see that it gives that nice little underlined syntax. And I'm getting the source code for the thing that's built into ASP.NET Core. I'm telling you, I do it all the time. I promise you. And you're gonna see that validation problem details inherits from HTTP validation problem details, which in and of itself inherits from problem details. So why validation problem details? Well, it's an object purpose built for exactly the use case that we're looking for. Sending bad requests back to the client so that way they know how to fix the error that they're getting. Now we can refactor our post endpoint to use that. We're gonna just call that method to validation problem details. Boom, boom, to validation problem details. You see that we get it in our editor. You hover over, you see that it is indeed an extension. We're not calling the method and we need to, otherwise it's just going to say, you know, it's just going to return back a reference to the method, which we don't want. So we're gonna get open, close parens, call that method. And then we're gonna go back here. We're gonna hit play. And we're gonna get back our validation problem detail. Notice that the error message is now exactly bound to the member that failed. So a React app could now take this and say, oh, well, I know what field the last name came from, right? So I'll just put this error message under that last name field, right? So this is giving us pretty much all of the, pretty much anything that we need to really have a strong validation story for an API that might be an external API. Somebody might be calling it from another external system, or we might be building this API for a front end. So you get a lot of power here, which is really awesome. Imagine that you're in a payroll system with this endpoint brings back all inactive employees, right? And you're working in a company of 10,000 active employees and they've had 100,000 people. You probably don't want to send back all of that data. So I do want to show you how I would refactor this and how I would refactor this in the real world to be able to add some filtering and pagination. So let's go ahead and do that. We are actually going to introduce a thing called get all employees request. And we're going to put it inside of our, we're just going to put it right here for now. And then we will command dot and move type to its own thing. That's perfect. Get all employees request. But you might be saying, Spencer, we can't use gets and we can't put bodies. We can't put a body of data inside of a get. That kind of breaks what a get is intended to be. Well, not to worry, because we can actually add it to the employee controller. Check this out. So we're going to do, we're going to stop this, get all employees request. We're going to call it request, and then we're going to prefix it with this from query. Okay, we're going to prefix it with from query. And what that's going to instruct ASP.NET Core to do is read all those values from the query string, bring them into this request. So that's pretty cool. Because we actually created our validation filter earlier in the course, we also can create a validator for this thing because we don't want this page number to be less than zero. That doesn't make any sense. And we don't want the number of records to be zero or less than one. We need to be able to pull back at least one record. So we're going to go ahead and do that. We're going to copy in this validator and import this. And because we've already wired fluent validation up to our dependency injection pipeline, we've already defined a filter to actually execute this for us. We don't have to do anything else. We can just put it here and then write our tests and make sure everything's good to go. Now we can change our get employees implementation to add paging and filters. And let me show you what that looks like. So first things first, we are actually going to make sure that in our request, that if we're getting a page, we're gonna get int page number, and we're gonna say request, because we don't know that the get all employees request, it could possibly be null if there's no query string parameters provided. Can't recall if ASP.NET Core automatically instantiates one for you anyways, even with no query parameters, but we're gonna program defensively and assume that it could be null. So we're gonna say request.page, and then we're gonna say one. If this thing is null, then we're just gonna say, we just wanna go for the first page. And then we wanna say int number of records, and we're gonna say request number of records, records per page, I should say. And if that's not set, we'll just say 100 records per page. And then we're gonna change this a little bit. We are going to actually declare this as an iQueryable, and I'll show you why here in a second. So we are going to go for the broader type. Normally this would go and get the DB set, but we're gonna actually declare it as an iQueryable. I'm gonna take out the call to this, and I'm gonna actually rename this to query. I'm specifically marking it as a query because I wanna make it clear that that's what this is. I'm building a query here. So I'm going to say this is a link method called skip, which is to say skip these number of records. And I'm just gonna do a little bit of math to say if we're anything beyond page one, we wanna skip that number of records and provide them on a second page. And then we're gonna use another method called take, which is to say give me only these number of records. So we're saying here that we only want this number of records. We only want to skip this many. So if they request page one, one minus one is zero, so it won't skip any records. And we want to include benefits. Now we can add in this part and basically say if our request is not null, then if we can build upon our query based on the value of the request. So we want to add in a first name contains and a last name contains. And then we want to say if first name contains is not null or white space, then we want to change our query and set it so that we also check to see that the first name contains this value. And then down here, of course, we don't have our employees declared, so we will go ahead and do that. So we will say var employees equals await query. So we're done building our query to array async, and then we will send back our employee records. We can then add a new test to actually get only John to see if we get back a single employee. So now we can test our behavior for our single employee get, which we will do here. And we'll run that test. And we will see that it passes as well. So you can see that we are passing in the employee first name contains John. So if we had something in here that of a name of a person that does not exist, we'll go in .NET test and we'll see that it fails because we are expecting back a single employee from this.